European colonialism in Burma didn't start in the 19th century with Great Britain, but in the 16th century by an empire even greater than them, one that spoke Portuguese. In 1453, the age of exploration had started because of the Ottoman blockade of Constantinople, their conquest of Byzantium, and the end of the historic Silk Road. This road was created in 130 BC and was used as a connection between East and West. And when this was destroyed, the two could no longer reconnect as they used to. This led to people like Christopher Columbus looking for a new road to Asia and eventually discovering the New World. At that time, Europeans started exploring Asia, Africa, and the Americas. Trade routes were remade between Europe and Asia as well. Some major trading hubs of Asia were in India, China, Japan, and the Indonesian islands. Trading cities also existed in Burma as well. They were Pegu, Siriam, Martaban, Sandaway, and many more. And some of these Europeans who came to Burma were either Christians, merchants, or mercenaries. They were mostly Portuguese or Dutch. However, Marco Polo was the first to come to Burma, and he did so during the first Mongol invasion of Burma under the Yuan dynasty. He called Burma Mien, after the Chinese name Mien Yen, and this came from another name for the Burmars, Mran Ma. This name was used in his book, Travels of 1298, and apparently he saw unicorns in Burma. However, this story is for another time, because our story starts in the 16th to 17th century, during the race between Spain and Portugal to expand their empires and exert their dominance over the world. Felipe de Brito y Nicot, later known as Ngazinga, was born to Jules Nicot, a possible brother of Jean Nicot. He was born in 1566 in Lisbon, Portugal. He traveled to Burma in the 1580s to 90s under the command of King Shilimisha, also known as Minrazaji of Arakan. Around that time, the once mighty Tongu Empire was in shambles after the death of King Bayinnaung in 1581. Now, he wasn't the first or the second king of Tongu, but he was crucial in its expansion and influence over Southeast Asia. He made Tongu the largest Southeast Asian nation, and his death led to numerous uprisings, wars, and an opportunity for power. This was made clear during Tongu's unsuccessful Nandrig War against Siam in 1584 to 1593. Siam defeated Tongu and regained former Siamese lands with the help of Portuguese mercenaries. Then, in the 1580s to 90s, the soldiers of Lower Burma and those near Pegu became monks and led to the decrease in Burmese manpower. Pegu or Pego was the capital of Tongu, and this event led to their decline. Because of this, Minrazaji took Pegu with his mercenaries during the Narasuan War of 1593 to 1600. By 1595, Siam took the Tenasserim coast. Arakan took Lower Burma in 1598 and then Pegu in 1599. The two would clash over lands of Tongu and Pegu as well. After the war, Minrazaji gave his mercenaries the city of Siriam and made Felipe the governor of the city. However, Felipe soon became too arrogant and powerful and wanted his own empire for God, glory, and gold. So he turned one of the Siriam customs or government buildings into a fort, and he was also a ridiculously good fighter and commander as well. He told Minrazaji that it was for trade and troop training. However, his real intentions were to overthrow Arakan. After the fort's construction, Minrazaji took it from him and gave it to Banya Dawa, the leader of Martaban.
So, Sir King X, we have finished our fort.
Oh, mi hermano, yo quiero hablar con vos.
Wait, what's going on, sir?
Felipe, nos now vamos to the ciudad.
Wait, what?
Vamos there a ciudad para otra persona.
But who? Yo. But how?
Porque você não é bom, meu amigo.
No, mate. How are y'all better at speaking Portuguese than me?
Que?
Have you ever wondered or ever considered learning Portuguese? Well, I didn't either. But guess what? I just happened to be there at the right time on Duolingo for me to learn Portuguese. And well, I fell in love quickly with how easy it was to learn. And so, it really helped me on this journey to find Portuguese King of Pangu. So here are some things that I used. Well, first I used Duolingo, Busuu, well I used to use Busuu. And then the third thing is Memrise. And also I use Bing Translate and Google Translate for translating large amount of text. And you know what? After learning Portuguese, you know, I could say that it's kind of like Spanish, but Russian. But it also that it's very good. So if you want to, you could try it. Yeah, thanks for watching. From 1600 and onwards, Felipe had stopped obeying Erican and started fighting them instead. He launched an assault on Banya Dala to take back his fort and told Mirzaji that Banya was in the wrong. However, Mirzaji didn't believe him and so attacked him on land and by sea together with Tangu, but failed. During the fighting, Felipe went back to Goa to get more men and also to receive the titles Commander of Syria, General of the Conquest of Pegu, and King of Pegu. He also kidnapped Mirzaji's son, Ming Kamau, in 1603 while facing off against Tangu and Erican. In the end, he was very successful and made Mirzaji his subject. However, peace was not imminent as Felipe sent his own son to meet the defeated Erican for favors, but instead the Ericanese killed his son, leading to another conflict. Felipe married the daughter of Banya, presumably to resolve tensions, and he started to force convert the local population to Catholicism. He destroyed Buddhist artifacts and temples. He even stole the Damazedi bell in 1608, which made the people and King Anok Betlun of Tangu despise him. And so, Felipe became allies with King Ekatotsarot of Siam, along with Anok Petlun's cousin, Prince Nashinang of Tangu. Anok Petlun invaded Tangu City in 1610 to defeat his cousin and retake the city. Felipe captured Nashinang and escaped as the city fell to Tangu. During this time, the Burmese-Siamese War of 1609 to 1622 was in full motion, and the Burmese troops invaded Siam and Felipe's empire and slowly won victory over victory. By 1612 to 1613, the Burmese had surrounded Siam and encircled Felipe's fort. Then, in 1612, Nashinang converted to Catholicism, and he had a falling out with his cousin. However, the Burmese forces overran the armies of Siam and Felipe and recaptured Pegu and Siam by April. Felipe and Nashinang were crucified and impaled, and their fort was destroyed. That ended Felipe's empire. His Portuguese mercenaries would then be enslaved and relocated up north. The Siamese would go on to lose that war, and Burma would regain some former Tangu territories from their neighbors without any more Portuguese harassment. But what about Salvador? No, not that one. This one. Ribeiro de Sousa, later known as Masinga, was a really unknown and silent character. In fact, we don't even know when he was born or when he died. However, he was there all along. As son of Frutoso Gonçalves Cardote, he was said to have royal blood and was born in Ronfig, Guimarães, Portugal in the 16th century. He left for India in March 26, 1587 and later went on military campaigns overseas throughout the world in the name of God, glory, and gold. Eventually, in 1600, he wanted to return to Portugal to collect the combined earnings of him and his two dead brothers. He was in Ceylon at the time and he wanted to go to Portugal, but he had to cross to Goa. However, the weather caused him to arrive in Burma instead. By June, he arrived in Siam 1 month after the Narasuan War. There he met Felipe de Brito in Nicot, and the two proved to be very skilled fighters for Erican, and they both wanted their own empires. After the Portuguese were allowed to build a port in Syria, Salvador slowly turned it into a fort and joined Felipe in their war against Banya and Erican. When Felipe had left for Goa in 1603, Salvador was put in charge of their fort, and so he defended the fort from Banyadala's land and sea invasions. Soon he started taking the offensive against Arakan and Tongu. After Felipe returned, Salvador gave him back his kingdom. However, the population started to respect Salvador more than Felipe because of Felipe's war on Buddhism. He was unofficially made king of Pegu by the people and received the name Che Masinga, which apparently meant God on earth at that time. However, he didn't stay long in Burma. Instead, he returned to Portugal before Felipe's death in 1613. He then died in Alenquer, Portugal in the 17th century. His life and story was forever immortalized in Guimarães, his birthplace's municipality, and in a book written about him. A street was even named after him, Rua do Rei de Pegu, or Street of the King of Pegu. However, it was renamed to Rua dos Bombeiros Voluntarios, which meant Street of the Voluntary Firemen, in 1988. But there is still a street named Rua do Rei Pegu, King Pegu Street, which is not so far away from the other. Suffice to say that both Salvador Ribeiro de Sousa and Felipe de Brito y Nicot left a mark on Portuguese and Burmese history. However, were these the only kings of Pegu? I asked ChatGPT if any other kings existed, and I will link the answers in my document. But I mean, like, they weren't even interesting, and so I wanted to find out more. But before we go on, there was still one thing that had been bugging me since the start. You see, there was an article named Salvador Ribeiro de Sousa, A King Without a Kingdom, Vestiges of 16th Century Burma and Portugal, and a book named Interferencia e Integração dos Portugueses na Birmania, which both claim that King Philip III of Spain, also known as King Philip II of Portugal, thought that the Burmese had elected him to be their king of Pegu, and so he took up this mantle. Except that it didn't happen. According to ChatGPT, Bing AI, and many other sources online, this event never happened. Now, to be fair, Bing AI didn't even acknowledge Salvador Ribeiro's existence when asking about the kings of Pegu. However, because King Philip was a king, an actual king, you would expect to find numerous sources and papers on this, more so than Felipe or Salvador. But because I couldn't find any, I excluded him from this official list, but put him down here. And well, with all of that said, thank you for watching this video, and see you in the next one. As always, the sources will be linked down below. Obrigado e tchau.